I was born and raised in Paris, but I became a physician and a neuroscientist in the United States at the University of Pittsburgh. One day, in my own brain scanning experiment, one of the subjects didn't come. I ended up going to the scanner myself, and this is how I discovered that I had brain cancer. The book I wrote, it's also the book I wish I'd had with me throughout my journey with the illness. The first thing I learned is that every one of us has cancer cells. Yet only one out of three of us in the West will die of cancer, and two out of three won't. That means that for these two out of three, they have natural defenses that can help slow down the disease. So what we need to do is nourish life in us. When we do that, we're healthier, we're happier, we prevent disease from developing, and if we are already ill, then we're helping our body fight as well as it ever can. Food is something you do three times a day to your body every day. And we know that these phytochemicals that are part of everything you eat have a profound influence on your physiology. So think about the fact that with what you eat every day, three times a day, you're modifying your physiology. It's as if like you're playing keyboard on the piano with the foods you eat. So this is why I pay attention to what I eat. Ever since the relapse of my tumor, I've learned that I'm playing keyboard on that tumor with what I eat. And I try to include things in my meals every day that come and bring in chemicals from the food that fight cancer. A variety of them. You see, the beauty of food is that it doesn't target just one mechanism of cancer. It plays on the whole range of the keyboard. So, you know, turmeric will act on certain aspects of cancer biology, but the sulforaphane and indole-3-carbinols of cabbage or broccoli will play on another aspect, and then green tea with its EGCG and polyphenols will yet play on another aspect, and then I add raspberries or blueberries to and make that my dessert, and I'm bringing in another range of phytochemicals that will yet act on a different mechanism of cancer. And throughout the day, every day, three times a day, I'm building an anti-cancer biology. And I think anybody can do that. We just need to tell them how they can do it. The World Cancer Research Fund says that the goal should be for people to eat no more than 11 ounces of red meat per week. We're currently in the United States close to 11 ounces of red meat per day. Now, red meat is a hell of a lot more expensive than lentils, beans, and cereals, or soy, tofu, sources of vegetable protein that can replace meat, act as anti-cancer agents, and allow us to reduce considerably our intake of animal products, and especially red meat. Similarly, the vegetables that are best for you are some of the cheapest ones. You can add garlic, onions, and leeks to almost every dish that you cook, aside from desserts. And if you do that, it doesn't cost a lot of money, and it builds a strong anti-cancer diet. Another question that comes up all the time is, do you really need to eat organic foods? Well, there's no question it's better to eat organic foods. We have studies showing that when children are on an organic diet, the residues of pesticides in their urine that you can measure every day goes way down. So it's better to eat organic foods. However, overall, there's no question that you're better off eating broccoli with a few residues of pesticides on them than not eating broccoli. I think people don't realize the impact that a little bit of physical exercise can have on the physiology of the body and its ability to resist a variety of illnesses, including cancer. For example, we now have studies showing that a woman who has had breast cancer and walks 30 minutes six times a week, and that can include walking to and from work, that woman reduces her chances of a relapse by 50%. The best drugs we have don't do better than that, and nothing prevents you from taking the drug and walking to work. It has a huge impact on our ability to resist the biology of cancer. If we don't tell people that science shows how much they can protect themselves from this disease with their own choices and what they decide to take in their own hands. If we don't tell them that, we're giving them false hopelessness. And we know that hopelessness actually can promote the growth of cancer. And this is what I'm against. False hopelessness. The psychology with which we face our journey is also important. We know that each one of us who has the opportunity to find someone, and doesn't have to be a husband or a wife, it could be a brother or a sister, it can be a friend, it can be a health professional, someone who just cares about what is happening to us. If we can extend ourselves and receive that person's help, then we know our biology is soothed in a profound way in the inside. And I really like this idea that developing a healthful life, nourishing life in us, starts with spending a little bit of time by ourselves, for ourselves, focused on what it is like to be alive every day. You get that? Okay.